Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County, New Jersey chapter of the National Organization of Women. I'm Laura Mattia, and I and the entire production crew are members of the Morris County chapter of NOW. The show is in the 20th year of production, and all of our shows are archived in the Sophia Smith Collection at Smith College, and are also available at YouTube at www.youtube.com/MCNOWNJ. Today we're going to discuss why earned sick days for New Jersey working families would be good for business and good for the economy, and also how we can ensure that all workers in the Garden State receive earned sick days. We're fortunate today to have two well-informed and involved guests to help us understand this very important topic. Anita Thomas has over 30 years experience as a business leader in telecommunications, medical education, and communications, while honing her arts administration skills as a consultant to visual and performing arts organizations. For the last 5 years, she served as the executive director of the Carolyn Dorfman Dance Company, New Jersey's premier modern dance company. Anita has a BS in community development from Penn State, MA in Media Studies from the New School for Social Research. She is one of the founding business leaders of New Jersey Citizen Action's Main Street Alliance, having joined in 2008 to fight for healthcare and financial reform. Welcome, Anita.
Thank you.
Now, Yarrow William Cole, is assistant director with the Working Families Program at the Center for Women and Work at Rutgers University, assisting in all aspects of research, outreach, and education on family-friendly workplace policies. Current projects include research on the impact of New Jersey Family Leave Insurance Program on New Jersey businesses, outreach and education on earned sick days, and the New Jersey Time to Care Coalition's work on the local, state, and national levels. Yarrow has over 10 years of experience as an educator, organizer, and advocate for underserved communities, including work in Honduras, Costa Rica, and New York City as both a teacher and a community organizer. Welcome, Yarrow.
Thanks.
I'm so glad both of you have been able to come. This is a very important issue. You know, many employers and firms in New Jersey, as well as in the United States, do offer paid sick days. And so some of us aren't even aware that this is an issue. And I guess we take our sick days for granted now, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
As a small business owner myself and as an employer, I can't imagine not offering paid sick days to my employees. I think that it's just a matter of treating people decently.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think, I mean, this is really more a matter of actually how do we treat people?
I agree. The problem is in this state, however, for the many low-wage earners, the many people who are working in the service industry, the people who we're buying our coffee from at Dunkin' Donuts, they don't earn what should be a normal benefit that you should get as an employee who works, particularly for people who are serving customers. And so it doesn't seem commonsensical to me that there isn't some legislation around that everybody should just be able to have a couple of days off. I mean, because everybody gets sick, and people have children, and many low-wage workers tend to be women, and Yara's going to talk about that a little bit. Many people's kids get sick, and so it just makes sense to me that
we're human, right?
Right?
And we all get sick. So, and people are actually very surprised when they learn that people don't have this benefit. In New Jersey alone, we have over 1.1 million private sector workers that don't have access to any paid sick days.
Wow.
And it's 43 million in the whole country. So, you know, the other thing is people, it's not just they don't have it, but that it actually has a really big impact on their financial stability. One in six workers report actually being threatened with being, they're either actually fired, mm-hmm. threatened with being fired, or punished for just taking time off when they're sick or when a family member is sick. So the United States is, far behind also the rest of the developed world. We're the only country out of 22 developed countries, you know, with higher standards of living, supposedly, that don't have this minimum standard of paid sick days offered to the workforce. Mm-hmm. So it is a really big problem.
So it isn't just about not getting compensated. It's also people are fearful for their job. So they're going to come into work and mm-hmm. work anyway in a very uncomfortable situation because they don't feel well.
Right, and they have that term is sort of called presentism. As opposed to absenteeism.
Right.
They actually come to work and they are ill. They're not going to be as productive. They're not going to be as focused. And again, depending on what field you're in, if you are taking care of an elderly person, if you're doing daycare work, and if you're serving people food, you're actually, there's a public health angle to this.
Right.
Absolutely. Because
there's layers of issues.
Yes. And yeah. So, And it goes to the economic instability that people have.
Right.
Because, and again, if you take the day off, even if they don't fire you, you don't get paid. Mm-hmm. And most people, again, because your wages aren't great, can't afford to take a day off without pay.
Because I think, like Anita had said, it does disproportionately impact low-wage workers who are a majority of the low-wage workers are women. Yeah. Who are also the primary caregivers frequently uh-huh. for families. Uh-huh. And so they are often, and it's very important to understand though it isn't just an issue that is important for women. You know, women have historically kind of been at the forefront of fighting for family-friendly workplace policies, but it's an issue that impacts okay, everyone, the entire family. Mm-hmm. And you know, the benefit isn't about, you know, are you a woman, are you a man? It's are you a worker that wants to do good work, be a productive worker, and also a responsible family member
right.
and take
right.
care of your family and not risk losing, you know, your financial stability.
Yeah. As someone that's a big advocate for financially empowering women, I do a lot of work around that area. And, you know, clearly we still have a gender pay gap, even though some people don't want to admit to it. Even when they reconcile for all the possible contingencies, they're still not able to close that gap. You know, there's this issue of really wanting to make female-friendly work environments, and this absolutely has, you know, has a female component to it. But I think what... I guess at one point you were saying something about, to me, offline about the fact that our workforce and our
right.
workforce policies don't really match.
Right. I mean, so our workforce is really set up for what happened, the workforce that existed in the 50s and the 60s, right, where we have this expectation that the ideal worker is essentially the male ideal worker, right, of the 50s and 60s that could work 5 days a week, 9 to 5, and come home to the wife who was able to be the full-time stay-at-home caregiver. That's no longer the case for a variety of reasons.
And it hasn't been the case
for a while, right?
For probably 2 decades.
I mean, in particular, we know now that half the workforce is made up of women, and the majority of mothers work outside of the home, whether they're married or single. And so there isn't that full-time stay-at-home person, which mm-hmm. historically has been the female, right? To take care of the kids when they're sick, to take care of even aging parents, which, of course, now that's even more of an issue. We see the baby boomers, my mm-hmm. parents, mm-hmm. that are aging and are going to need more care as, mm-hmm. you know, they're getting older. So, you know, there's a lot of issues that are not that are changing with the workforce that are not being reflected in the workplace.
In terms of policies, like benefits, employee
right.
policies.
Exactly.
And again, I think it impacts women, but you need to have a family friendly, and I think mm-hmm. what seems not to be happening in industry today is that there aren't family friendly policies. Mm-hmm. And of course, the lower wage you earn, and we all know that even if a woman is in a managerial position, she's still not earning the same amount as a man. And again, the work for taking care of the family, taking care of the kids, it's still disproportionately falling on women.
Mm-hmm.
And so not having something that is like so such a simple thing to enact, and it's not an expensive thing on a business to do. And I know that there's been a lot of hype that's come from places like the NFIB, the National Federation of Independent Businesses, that it's going to be very costly. But there's countless research out there that just says that's just not true.
Right. And then, actually, getting back, I just want to mention, because you said you said it differently, but presentism?
Yeah, presentism. Uh-huh.
Well, there's actually research that showed the lost productivity from people coming to work when they're sick is around $160 billion a year.
Oh, okay.
Which is more than the cost of absenteeism. So that's like a huge impact on businesses, on the economy, that that often businesses don't take into account, right? Because, I mean, you are the expert in the area of businesses looking at the bottom line and maybe not always projecting forward some of those more, let's see, big box companies, let's say, right? But it is a major issue as far as the cost and the savings. I mean, we could talk more about turnover,
retention of employees, the cost, the cost to train people when they do leave, if you don't have benefits, and if you're in a competitive, all of us, even in a dance company in New Jersey, there's still multiple dance companies, I still have to compete for dancers. And the way that you retain people is by giving them benefits that maybe your competitor's not giving. And so it's just, again, I just want to continue to say, it's just common sense to provide something as basic as, basically.
But that's the business argument, right? Let the market force work. Let people, if people are not happy with their compensation package, which includes earned sick days, they should go elsewhere. Why aren't they just finding other jobs? But
well, the economy.
The reality,
the reality
is,
I mean, the economy collapsed. We don't have the same number of jobs. You know, I'm sure everybody is, has been reading the paper about the lack of job growth in New Jersey in particular, and how we have not retained, we have not regained jobs that we lost, like the surrounding states. Mm-hmm. And so you can't just leave.
Mm-hmm. And I think the other important point to mention, and you know more about this, but the fact is by creating this standard, you're creating a floor for small businesses that often do offer this benefit because they see their employees as family. They, you know, understand a little more directly what it means to offer these benefits to their employees, but then what you see is who's actually not offering it typically are the larger,
really large corporations.
So, right, the big box companies. And so by having a floor, you're allowing the small business owner to remain competitive without, you know, by requiring these larger employers to offer the same thing that they're doing because they are usually doing the right thing because they see the impact on their workforce more directly.
That's interesting. Mm-hmm. So we have precedents, right? There's two cities in New Jersey that have implemented
the largest cities in New Jersey.
So it hasn't gone into effect yet in Newark.
Okay.
It just went into effect at the end of January in Jersey City. But San Francisco has had it in effect for over 6 years, and research there has shown that there's very businesses actually support it, the majority of them. You may have information too. And they report very, very negative, very few negative consequences, especially financially. I mean, San Francisco is growing, is booming. So this is not realistically causing job loss in these places where it's been implemented. And the momentum is growing. But yeah, go ahead.
So, you know, because one of the things I wanted to do was make sure that we had some statistics here. So in Seattle, for instance, they just did it took effect in September 2012. There were 7,200 more retail jobs, 3,200 more food service and drinking place jobs in a county called King County during the first 7 months of 2013 than in the same period in 2012. And so again, the economy has come back to places like Seattle. And the main opponents of this tend to come from the drinking place establishments.
The restaurant industry is a big...
Food service?
food services. And so
you mean the opposition, though? You're saying specifically, right?
Yes.
There's the organization that is a lobbyist for
those are exactly the people we don't want serving food to us when they're sick.
Right.
Absolutely.
And that's a big component of this is the public health impact, which we could talk about a little bit more if you like. I mean, 76% of food service workers or hotel workers in New Jersey don't have earned sick days. So what does that mean as a consumer, as a customer in establishments where you don't know if maybe a worker feels like they just have to go into work because that you know they don't want to lose that pay because you know that's a big impact on their bills. And so that puts the public at risk. They actually said that during the H1N1 epidemic a few years ago, the lack of workers having paid days off could have caused an infection of an additional 1.7 million people. I mean, and the CDC actually recommends staying at home when you have a contagious illness or influenza. But what happens when you don't have that choice, you know, to be able
to? So this should almost be a list that consumers can go to say, all right, these people don't offer their...
Oh,
their
yeah.
Employees.
And there are a list of places. And I have to say, sort of personally, when this whole thing started coming about as an issue for the Main Street Alliance to tackle, we had gone to a seminar based on the restaurants in particular. And they will remain nameless, but it's a chain that I used to frequent with a lot of my friends. And I stopped doing it because it just doesn't make any sense that incredibly successful chains that are packed with people every day are not offering their employees paid sick leave.
That chain is the one that gave Newark a hard time. I think I know who you're talking about.
We'll remain nameless.
Okay. So Newark, I didn't realize Newark didn't start yet, but okay. So when are they?
I believe it's May 29th. Of course, you know, they have a new administration coming on board. So, you know, they're in a transition period. Right. But we are, when I say we, I'm talking in terms of the coalition, the New Jersey Time to Care Coalition that has over 100 different organizations from a range of types of work, like Now New Jersey, religious organizations, unions, lots of nonprofits, Main Street Alliance, coming together around this issue. And the coalition is working with the cities to make sure that the public is aware that this benefit is something they can access in Jersey City and Newark. And the cities are, the mayor in Jersey City is you know, really outspoken and supportive about the passage of this bill and is really excited about spreading the word. And I believe the mayor of Newark is.
And in fact, Steve Fulop, is that how you say his name? He was just on a due process program at NJTV, and he talked about how he has actually put people in place to try to get the message out. Because again, when a lot of these new policies come in, just like the Affordable Care Act, there needs to be education about it's available. And that's one of the things that the Main Street Alliance tries to do with the 1,400 members that we have, is to let them know that these policies are in place, these benefits are in place. And there's a cupcake owner called Sweet Retreat. His name is Larry Kenny in Newark. When we went around sort of canvassing and talking about what was about to happen in Newark, he, at the time, he has 5 employees. He hadn't been offering paid sick days. But when we talked to him about, well, the city is about to enact it, it will help your employees at least have some sense of more stability working for you. And he's like, well, that makes sense to me. And he says, and if it's only a couple of days, I don't want them. He says, now I'm thinking about it. I mean, they are, like, sitting here cooking food that we're selling to people. So I guess I really need to try to make sure that I'm taking care of that. And, you know, to Yaro's point, you know, many small businesses, when they come about, they're started by family members.
Right.
And even when a company, fortunately, if it expands, they still treat the new employees who come in just like the family members who help them start the nonprofit or the small business. And so most people would want to do it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they do need to be incentivized by it if it's not coming about naturally. But the vast majority of small businesses, particularly Main Street Alliance businesses, they're already trying to offer it, or if it comes, it'll just be something that will become part of just the normal business operating practices.
And how many days are we talking about?
So it's different. Let's pick a city. Which city? Should we go with Jersey City?
Okay.
All right, so Jersey City, the bill says that all workers can earn, private sector workers, I should say, they earn 1 hour of paid of sick time for every 30 hours worked. It's only job protected for employees that work in a place with only 10 or fewer, or nine, I should say, fewer than 10 employees. Right. So that they aren't required to pay them. But over 10, they have five. So it's capped at five paid sick days. Jersey City is looking at doing a study at the end of the first year of this this benefit, and looking at potentially strengthening it, they've said publicly. So,
and in fact, they're going to be doing a study because Rutgers, they've already contacted Rutgers to be the institution that's going to help them study the impact. So,
okay, that's great.
So that's Jersey City. In Newark, it's actually even a little more generous. Private sector workers earn one hour of paid sick time for 30 hours worked, and it caps at five if they work at a place that has 10 or fewer employees, unless they work directly with the public. And then, all of them earn at least three, but they earn more if they work directly with the public or if they work at a firm that's over 10. So that everyone in Newark has at least three paid sick days, if not five, depending on where they work. And the other thing in Jersey City also, the benefit is the standard for the type of business as far as the number includes franchises. So some of those smaller coffee places that may only have under 10 employees are actually, they may have another establishment within the city, and they would be counted as far as having to provide the five paid sick days. Yeah.
So why do you think this is such an important issue, particularly for New Jersey? And what about the other states? What are the other states doing?
Right. Well, so in New Jersey, I think besides the fact that we have so many hardworking New Jersey people that don't have this benefit, that have to make that hard decision between going to work sick or leaving their sick child, with a stranger at home without, caring for them, that's something that no one should have to face. But New Jersey's unique because family leave insurance is something that we established about 5 years ago. We were the essentially third state to do that. And that was a really important program that provides paid leave for parents to bond with a newborn, a newly adopted child, or to care for a family member when they're severely ill. And that program has been successful, maybe not as widely known as it should be, because there hasn't been a lot of outreach and education. And so New Jersey has essentially been at the forefront of implementing family-friendly workplace policies. And so really having Jersey City and then Newark take this issue on and make sure their workers have this benefit is just saying that we're going to make this work for our workforce, for our economy, for our businesses. And so we need to make sure that there's a FLORA standard for the entire state. So it's easier, actually, for businesses to know what is expected of them if there's a state standard.
Right. And there's a couple of Connecticut has also.
So Connecticut's the only state that actually has implemented.
There's just the state.
Right. And there's just other cities, like I mentioned, San Francisco, Seattle, Washington, D.C., of course, New York City, our neighbor next door. Their bill went into effect in April.
Yeah, I think that's sort of an interesting point because the alarmists who come from, again, people supposed to be representing small businesses, even though they're funded by major corporations or very wealthy people. The sky did not fall in New York. It is being implemented. It was not a sick out. Everybody didn't call in sick the day that they got it.
Oh, I should actually mention, because you say that.
Okay.
That in San Francisco, where it's been implemented the longest, those studies have shown that employees look at it as more of an insurance policy, essentially. And so those that have earned sick days take approximately 3.9 earned sick days for themselves, and 1.3 if they're taking it for family, to take care of a family
member. So it's not abusive.
And then if you don't have paid sick days, on average workers take 3. So you don't see, right, a huge increase or abuse.
And then I guess the other thing that just doesn't make any sense to me as a head of an organization, if someone's abusing any benefit, you fire them. All my employees are at will. I don't even have to have a reason to fire them. So it just doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, in terms of being like a hardcore, hard-nosed business person, I'm not going to let anybody abuse any policy that's a part of my organization. But what I do want to try to do is to make sure that I'm not having such onerous things happening to my employees that they want to leave, or that I'm actually making them sick.
Mm, right. So, Yara, you mentioned that the other acts, the
earned sick day?
No, the one
family leave insurance.
Yes, yeah. Was not promoted enough, and right. That people don't know that as much about it. How are you getting the word out about this, and how can people support you and get involved?
Well, there's lots of ways.
Okay.
First of all, I think it's really important for individuals and business owners that have a personal story. For workers, maybe they have actually experienced job loss because they had to stay home or they had to take care of a sick child. And it's important that they come forward and they join this larger coalition to speak out about and really explain with their own personal stories about why this isn't such an important policy. And we have a website that actually has audio stories and photos of from individuals and small business owners that are supportive of the earned sick day issue. And so folks can go to the website njtimetocare.com or .org.
Okay, and we'll be showing that website at the end of the show.
We'll be showing the websites for both organizations.
And organizations that want to join the coalition to get involved in the campaign are also welcome to get on the website and get more information there. But it is really important that policymakers understand why this is a real issue that affects real people, and they hear from their constituents and the workers in the state. And we're just getting the word out. We're always available for presentations. We're always available. We have materials that we can give people with the details of family leave insurance that's in now coming into its 5th year of existence, and what earned sick days means too. So we have all sorts of information.
Okay, and Anita, Main Street Alliance, can you talk about
it? It's www.njmainstreetalliance.org. We are growing in leaps and bounds. Because I'm one of the founding members from 2008. We started out with about 100 companies who are now small businesses. We're now up to over 1,400. And again, part of what we have done, and this is one of the reasons why I'm here tonight, is to make sure that we actually have gone to Congress, we have gone down to the State Assembly, and just told our stories about how we're running our businesses, how we are not opposed to the activities that we're trying to do for positive policies. And so we want more people to come forward to say, raise their hand and say, this is why it's important to me, and this is how I'm already doing it for my own business.
But you specifically would like business owners to
join the Main Street Alliance.
Okay.
And they're coming to be a part of this. There's a movement, and you have lots of company, and there's lots of information out there to support.
Not alone.
You're not alone.
Okay, that's very good. So this has been great. We're going to be showing your websites at the bottom of the screen, and we really want to encourage people to get involved and to support this very, very important issue, but it's something that was completely not even on my radar, I'm sorry to say. So I'm really glad that you came here. Thank you so much for all the work that you're doing. Thank you for educating us on the whole overall program.
Well, thanks for having us.
Great.
Yeah, thank you for your interest. It's great.
Take care.